Good morning. Welcome to The Rock. Would you stand and sing with us?
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes.
I can't count the times I've called your name some broken night, and you showed up and patched me up like you do every time.
I get amnesia, I forget that you keep coming around.
Yeah, ain't no way you'll ever let me down.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs.
Tell me, is he good?
Tell me, is he God? He is good God Almighty.
You say your love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'd be somebody that you're not?
Like the sun in the morning, I know you're gonna be there every day.
So what on earth could make me be afraid?
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs.
Tell me, is he good?
Tell me, is he God?
Well, he is
good God Almighty.
Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him when the sun goes down.
Love him in the morning, love him in the noontime, love him when the sun goes down. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your God. He is good God Almighty.
Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime,
Jesus when the sun goes down. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the Tropical Rock. It's 15 degrees or so, about 30 degrees more than it was last week. So happy you're with us today. A few announcements before we get started. One, an important one, we will have a call meeting today at 3 o'clock to issue a call for hopefully our next pastor here at The Rock. The reason it's at 3 and not right away is we have to have a representative from the district, and Pastor David Palamanke from David City will be joining us, and so that's why it's at 3. So please come back and join us at 3 o'clock. We'd love for prayers, if you can't make it, prayers over the whole process. And what the process looks like, just to review briefly, we had a list of 15 names that we started with. We talked to those who were interested in things and ended up interviewing 3 candidates. And we'll be presenting those 3 candidates to the congregation today with some recommendations from the call committee to move forward. So please do come. There'll be lots more information to be shared at the meeting. If you want to come a little bit early, there's some information sheets if you want to take some time to look through it. Again, I'll be here a little bit early if you want to take some more time to look through things in advance of the meeting. Please feel welcome to do so. Prayer cards and information cards are available in your seat back, so please fill those out. If you'd like prayer this morning, please drop them in the offering basket when it is passed just a little bit later in our service. Good morning to those of you joining us on the live stream. We're so glad you're with us, and there are points of contact there for information or for prayer requests. Please use those information numbers. January item for the Blue Valley is soap and shampoo, so drop that out in the, there's a bin there on the table just right outside in the cafe. So anytime this month, please drop off soap and shampoo there. Women's Bible study is starting in February, so it'll be Sunday mornings during February, 8:45 a.m. to 9:30 in room 211, which is right downstairs. The book is The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry. For more information about that, if you go to the news tab on our website and look into the current news, there's information on how to get the book, reviews on it, that kind of thing. And if you have any questions, you can see Andrea right over here with any questions there. Anything I'm missing on that, Andrea? Oh, 8:30 to 9:45. So I've got to switch those around, 8:30 to 9:45. The Rock's hosting a Faith Partners comprehensive workshop on dealing with alcohol, drug, and mental health issues. That is in February, again, February 8th from 6 to 8, and February 10th from 9 to 4:30. Again, we'd love to get some people at The Rock with some more training on how to deal with those issues. And so if that's something you're interested in, again, see the news tab on our website for information on how to register for that. We've got a baby born at The Rock, and so we're collecting diapers for the next couple weeks, again, through till February 4th. Baby Monroe was born, and so size 2, 3, or 4, any brand, you can drop those out in the cafe the next few weeks as well to bless that family. If you made a gift to The Rock during 2023, the giving statements are out. There's a little box out there. They're in alphabetical order. Grab one for you, yours that way. That'll save us a stamp to have to mail those later. One other thing, Scott here. Yeah, so is it a go? I can announce it, but it's a go. So some of you may have noticed there's a, as you walked in, particularly the elevator, there's kind of a funny smell, a gas kind of smell. One announced that we're aware of it. The gas company was here on Friday and inspected everything, so it's not a natural gas leak. We're still trying to sort out exactly where the smell is coming from, but don't be alarmed. It's not something bad, but something we still need to figure out. So any questions, Scott can help with that. Anything else I am forgetting? All right, if you would stand up and greet one another. We're talking about questions from children this morning, so if you've had a fun question from a child lately, share that with your neighbor.
Good morning and welcome this morning to worship. We make our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, we continue with the Genesis Project. Today we look at a kind of a troubling portion of Scripture, and that is the sacrifice of Isaac. It's interesting that in the Jewish scriptures, they don't call it the sacrifice of Isaac, they call it the binding of Isaac. But our theme is from Genesis 22, and Isaac said to his father Abraham, "My father," and he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." So they went both of them together. Please be seated. We come into the presence of our God today, understanding that we don't deserve to be here. We come at His invitation. We come burdened with all of the stresses of life, all the things that are on our minds, our hearts, the fears, the worries, the guilt. We come confidently, knowing how much God cares about us. In Psalm 130, the psalmist cries out to God for deliverance. This psalm is one of the songs of ascent. It was used by the ancient Israelites as they went up to the temple. You went up to the temple physically. And as they went to the temple, these psalms were ones that they would sing. The Psalmodies is the hymn book of the Old Testament. And as they came to worship, they would be singing the songs of ascent. As we enter the worship of the same God, we echo their pleas to God to be merciful. Help, God, the bottom has fallen out of my life. Master, hear my cry for help. Listen hard, open your ears. Listen to my cries for mercy. If you, O God, kept a record of wrongdoings, who would stand a chance? So it turns out, forgiveness is your habit, and that's why you are worshiped. I pray to God, my life is a prayer, and wait for what He'll say and do. My life on line, O God, my Lord, waiting and watching till morning, waiting and watching till morning. O Israel, wait and watch for God. With God's arrival comes love. With God's arrival comes generous redemption. No doubt about it, He'll redeem Israel, buy back Israel from captivity to sin. Let's take a moment now and open our hearts to our God in private confession. And so we come confidently this morning. This translation of Psalm 130, this portion is from the translation called The Message. I like that because one of the ways it translates this portion is, forgiveness, O God, is your habit. That's who He is. He's love. He is forgiveness. And as we come to Him with expectant hearts, believing in the suffering and death of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for us, we know that all of our sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's where Israel met God. They met God at the temple. Early on in the wilderness, it was at the tabernacle. God dwelt among His people. God continues to dwell among us, and He continues to come to us, and we meet Him here again. We meet Him in this unique and incredible way under these humble forms of bread and wine. We believe in the real presence. We believe that under these forms of bread and wine is the true body and blood of Jesus Christ, given and shed for us. And indeed, if you believe that this is the true body and blood of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, we're able to come forward and once again meet our God in a very intimate and a very special way. For our Lord Jesus Christ, in the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also He took the cup, and when He had supped, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And now the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Praise to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, our God and our King. To him we will sing. In his great mercy he has given us life. Now we can be called the children of God.
Christ is
They think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect. You call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Who you are, it's who you are, it's who
And now may this true body and blood strengthen and keep you in the one true faith, even unto life everlasting. Now depart in peace and in great joy. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. And now let us rise as we join together in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. As God has so abundantly blessed us, let us return to him a portion of those blessings.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know everything I need you've got. There's honey in the rock. Praying for a miracle, thirsty for the living well. Only you can satisfy. At the mercy seat, now I've tasted, it's not hard to see, only you can satisfy. There's honey in the rock, there's honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock. in you, Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus.
Oh man, how sweet it is to be able to trust in Jesus. As we bring our prayers to Him, we know that already He is answering. Oh Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise You for the great blessings that You have given to us, especially in giving to us a Savior. Oh Lord, help us to cherish life as You do. In this time, we remember, oh Lord, that life is precious to You, even the unborn. And help us, O Lord, to embrace that love that You have. And, O Lord, we ask that You would bring to an end once and for all the tendency that we have to get rid of life just because it might be inconvenient. And, O Lord, be with those mothers who have been duped into believing that it is an answer to abort their unborn, how they must grieve. O Lord, heal their hearts also. Heal our nation and our world. O Lord, we also ask for healing for Scott, who is having surgery this morning. Also remember Sydney. We ask that You guard her in her pregnancy. And be with Roger as he has back issues. And we ask that You be with Morgan, who has terminal cancer. Bless and keep these, O Lord. If it be Your will, we ask You that You provide them with healing or give them grace to be able to accept whatever You may allow in their lives. And, O Lord, we ask that You be with us today as a congregation as we seek Your will to be able to extend a call for someone to come and to be a full-time under-shepherd here of Your flock. Bless all that we do, and help us to always turn to You, knowing that You already know that one who will serve here. These and all other things we have in our hearts and our minds, we bring before You, O Lord. And now we know that we can commend us and all that we have into Your good and gracious hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Invite you now to please rise as we join together in a prayer which our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. I invite you to sit back and to listen to one of the most dramatic accounts in all of Scripture. Genesis 22. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. He said, Take your son, your only son, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, Stay here with the donkey, and I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father Abraham, My father. And he said, Here I am, my son. He said, "Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went, both of them, together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand, took his knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in the thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of this place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." This is the word of the Lord.
After you, Jerry.
No, Barry, I insist.
You were here first, Jer.
Now, Bear, don't make me call HR on you.
So there we were, and my grandpa was trying to put a sweater on over his head, but he didn't have his glasses, so we're all like there saying, "Hey, come on, Grandpa, hold the phones here. Just a minute."
Wait, is that bacon I'm smelling? I'm gonna find that bacon and I'm gonna eat it. I may even throw a bacon party. I'll invite everyone in the office to come to my bacon party. I am so gonna get that raise.
Blah, blah, blah. We loved him so.
Oh, yeah, you know what? That reminds me of the time we went camping. I took 3 pounds of bacon in case there were bears. We went out to the Hawakatows, which is...
Here we go. Another Jerry story. I'd rather cram a miniature replica statue of the Empire State Building into my ear than listen to this garbage. Surely they make adult-sized underoos somewhere.
Blah, 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 blah. I do love camping, so...
Yeah, I bet they make Spider-Man ones, too. Hey, how about those TPS reports, huh?
Oh, I know, right? I mean, what a pain.
Oh, I know. I went into Human Resources the other day, and I saw Debbie there, and I was like, "Hey, Debbie, blah, 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 blah."
I have no idea where to go with this conversation. How did every kid in America know how to fix old Nintendo games by blowing on the cartridges? I mean, there were no internet forums or FAQs back then. It was pure instinct. Kids these days, their cheat codes, they're so soft.
The moral of the story is you cannot bring pets to work no matter how many forms you fill out.
You are the man.
Speaking of men, that reminds me, do you subscribe to Men's Health? I read an article the other day.
There were 4 sets of plastic utensils in that Chinese takeout bag last night. 4 sets. Someone at the restaurant packed my order, took a second to think about it, and estimated that there must be no less than 4 people eating to require such a large amount of food. I was eating by myself. There's nothing more humiliating than being made to feel like Jabba the Hutt before dinner.
Blah, blah, blah. So I thought you might be interested.
Good story.
Yeah, how about your grandpa? Where'd you say he was living again?
Oh, maybe you didn't understand what I was trying to say. What I was trying to say was my grandfather, he blah, 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 blah.
I look so good today. If I don't get a compliment or a second glance, then it's all going to be for waste. I'm so glad I have such awesome muscles.
Oh, your grandpa, he is so funny. He's a keeper. Don't let that one get away.
I just said he died.
don't.
Could I take you for a soda?
Leave.
Okay.
Better yet, I'll leave.
Status update. I just had the saddest conversation with a coworker. Why doesn't anybody listen to each other anymore? I grieve this. Well, time to get my bacon on.
Sometimes it's tough to really listen, isn't it? Well, in our Old Testament story for this morning, we step into the life and death test of one man's faith and obedience. Abraham is directed by God to sacrifice his only son as an act of worship on Mount Moriah. Suddenly, this boy, who has brought laughter to a couple in their elder years, now must have put a lump in his dad's throat. Yet it stands as a shining example of one man's faith and God's power to provide. Isaac was the dream child of Abraham and Sarah, raised with love and unusual devotion. His name means laughter, and he brings great joy to his parents. And even his mother managed to excommunicate Isaac's half-brother Ishmael into the wilderness so that there would be no sibling rivalry. Isaac had it all. When his daddy drags him out of bed before daylight and makes this mysterious, frightful trip into the unknown, I can only imagine what kinds of questions that had to be going on in this young adolescent's mind. I mean, the first question I would have asked is, where are we going? Maybe he asked some of the typical kid trip questions. Are we there yet? How much further? Can we stop now? Can you tell the donkey to stop looking at me? Daddy's looking at me again. Why isn't mother coming? How long will we be gone? But the Bible only records one question that Isaac asks, and it's simple, but it is profound. Will there be a sacrifice when we get there, Dad? We've got the wood, we've got the fire, but where is the lamb? Isaac knew to worship God meant to give up something, to surrender something, to forego something. It meant a lamb without blemish, the very best of the flock. Why would they be heading to worship without the essentials of worship? Sacrifice. It's kind of a strange word for us as Americans. You know, you think about it, we come to worship in 21st century America, hoping to get something out of it, maybe, to assess it, to comment on the sermon on the way home, if we remembered what the pastor said. But bring something to it? That's strange to us. To ask anyone to delay a gratification, to give up a possession, to forego a pleasure, even for God's sake, is strange in our culture. But Isaac asks the question. Of course, the sacrifice that God desires most is not an animal. It's us. St. Paul concludes his treatise on the righteousness of Abraham in Romans chapter 12 by saying, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to offer yourselves as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual act of worship. You know, maybe Isaac had other questions for Abraham. We're not told. What we are told is that Abraham takes this question of his young son and what ever others he may have had, and answers them with a profound statement that is repeated throughout this account. With every question, there is this answer: God will provide for himself the lamb for burnt offering, my son. The Lord will provide. Are you able to take time to listen to the questions of your children in order to reassure them that the Lord will provide? You know, our children, no matter what their ages may be, have profound questions about their world around them. And the older they get, the more complicated the questions become. Why? What? How come? Why not? What does this mean? What am I going to do? Who am I? And some of the most gut-wrenching questions come in the midst of trial and pain. What will happen to me? Will I be all right? And like Abraham, listening to our children gives us an opportunity to help them put their future and their hope in the right place. I don't know all the answers, my child, but I know the Lord who will provide. You know, this answer did not come to Abraham as an instantaneous insight. This answer was the result of Abraham and Sarah's numerous attempts to help God fulfill his promises. It involved things like Sarah trying to provide a son for her husband through her handmaiden Hagar. Boy, she regretted that choice as well as Abraham. Abraham, on the other hand, tried to claim that Sarah was his sister. All right, it was a half-truth, but still, he said that she's my sister in order to preserve his life in the midst of foreign nations. Not once, but twice he does this amongst the rulers of the lands they wandered, and the result was disastrous. Listening to the question of our children is critical. What are they really asking? You know, too often when my kids were growing up and asking questions about their world, I have to admit I really didn't listen to them. All I heard was, "What are you going to do to fix my world?" And that wasn't the question, but that's what I heard. You know, we want our best. We want the best for our kids, our grandkids. But when we try to do it ourselves, what happens is we point them to the world's solutions to life's questions and not God's answers. You know, we really sometimes have to do a little bit of self-examination. Why do I want my child to receive the best education possible? Why do I want my son or daughter to belong to this particular sports team or league? And how we answer, either with a response that honors God or one that glorifies the world, will determine if we love God above all else and are a witness to them. Do I want my son to play a sport so that he will achieve a better social status and maybe I can get some of the glory for that? Do I want my daughter to learn to play a musical instrument so that she will praise the Lord, or simply because we want to toot our own horn? Do we want them to get a good job so that they will use their knowledge and skills for the kingdom of God, or just so that they will have a life of abundance and a good socioeconomic status? What would it look like then to offer our children to God nowadays? We would do well to begin by imitating Abraham's example, listening to God's instruction and obeying even when God's call seems to run counter to the promise of success. Like Abraham, we must believe that God can fulfill his promises regardless of our circumstances. For success is assured to those who love God. After all, Paul says, all things work together for good to those who love God, who have been called according to his purpose. To offer our children to God is to agree to let go of the reins and give God the space to fulfill the promise of success. What children are really asking is, how can I be sure of the future and my place in it? When we really listen, it's then that our answer is to point them to the God who protected Abraham and Sarah from themselves and fulfilled his promise by giving them a son through the barren Sarah. Abraham knew from personal experience that God provided and would keep his promises. And from that trust and assurance, Abraham answers his son's question. And most importantly, Abraham believed that God would bring through Isaac's descendants the one who would be the Savior of the world. And that faith in God's promise was saving faith. He passed that assurance then on to Isaac. As they climbed the mountain on which God had commanded Abraham to sacrifice his son of promise, Mount Moriah, little did they know that it was there years later on this same mountain on which they stood that the temple would be built. It was on this mountain, centuries later, that another father would sacrifice his beloved son for the sins of the world. It was there that another son would cry out to his father, "If it is possible, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but yours be done." As Jesus, resolutely obeying the will of his father, carried the wood of the cross on his back and offered his life on Calvary's tree for you and for me. Now, we need to understand that in this specific case, what God asked of Abraham was unique. It was unique to Abraham. Abraham's faith in his Lord's promises concerning a Messiah through Isaac was so sure that according to the book of Hebrews, he believed that if he sacrificed Isaac, that God would bring Isaac back to life. And Isaac saw this faith in his father. Josephus, a Jewish historian, wrote about Isaac, said that he was about 25 years old, and that when he saw it was his father's intent to sacrifice him, trusting his father and trusting God, he rushed to the fateful altar. Isaac trusted his father, and Abraham trusted God. Did you hear it as I read? verses 17 and 18, as they saw the mountain and as they prepared to leave, Abraham speaks to his servants as he and Isaac head up the mountain. We will worship and then we will be back. This faith empowered Abraham to believe that the Lord would provide. And the Lord did provide. The drama is almost too much for civilized people. We shudder when Abraham arranges the wood. We gasp in disbelief as the boy is tied down. And in that microsecond between the raising of the knife and the release of the wrist that would have ended his own son's life, the angel of the Lord calls out, "Abraham! Abraham!" In that dramatic moment, when Abraham, already in his heart, had sacrificed his son, once again, God provided. Only twice in Scripture is this ever asked of a father. In the first case, here, God intervenes and provides for Abraham. In the second, and when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on that cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. The Lord will provide. He will provide faith for the journey. He will provide for our children in all of life and in the life to come. He will provide blessings for all time. In verses 17 and 18, we read, "I will surely bless you, Abraham, and through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed." In the obedience of Abraham, we glimpse the faithfulness of God, who was willing to sacrifice his only son for our salvation. The obedience, the righteousness of one man continues to be blessings for Christians like us. And that means that sometimes we and sometimes our kids have to go through tough times. Sometimes, rather than try to fix it for them, we just simply need to answer all of their questions with, "The Lord will provide." Now, somebody said that people are a lot like tea bags. You never know their real strength until you put them in hot water. On Mount Moriah, Abraham passed the test. Perfect score. But you know something else? God passed the test too. Abraham obeyed, but God provided. And by faith, you and I can discover the nature of the God whose hand has provided all that we need. The Lord will provide. Young Isaac asks, "Father, the fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham responded, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." In other words, "Son, I'm not sure how it's all going to work out, but I'm trusting that God will handle the details." And you know, that's all Isaac needed to hear. Isaac trusted the promise of his earthly father, just as Abraham trusted the promise of his heavenly Father. Amen. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in that one true faith, even unto life everlasting. Amen. And now as you leave this service to be in service to your God, leave with his promise of blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
And serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh, yes, I will lift you high.